everyone. It's great to be here today and to be able to address you. And it's also amazing to see so many partners in the room that we've been collaborating with. What I want to tell you a little bit about is this new platform that we launched. Many of you are involved in it. Some of you may know about it, called Loop, and sort of what we've learned so far, and also how does the whole thing work and what's coming up. So Loop launched, actually this was the photo of the very moment it came live and was announced to the public just this past January at the World Economic Forum. What to me was really exciting about this particular panel when we brought it to life is, yes, we had some amazing CEOs from David Taylor at P&G to Ramon at PepsiCo, but also Jennifer, who's the global head of Greenpeace, was on stage with us ushering in this new platform. And as background, TerraCycle, the company I've been running for 16 years, for which Loop is a division, has been focused, as many consumer product companies and retailers have been, to how do we recycle more things and how do we make more things from recycled materials? We just tend to focus on the areas that are hard to recycle or materials that are hard to integrate back into products. And 3 years ago or so, we started thinking, is that the final solution to waste? If we really take recycling and recycled content at a very high level, are we going to wake up in a place that we're very happy? And we realized that recycling is more of a solution to the symptom of waste than it is to the root cause. And that's what really created this whole conversation. So just to give you a sense of what's happening and where, this map shows you all the countries where TerraCycle operates in dark gray with our foundation in blue. Loop went live on May 14th with Carrefour in France, then on May 21st in the United States with Kroger and Walgreens. It will be going live later this year in the UK with Tesco, and then next year in Canada with Loblaw, in Germany with a major retailer there, same in Australia and Japan with major retailers, and also expanding to the West Coast. And the question Loop was thinking about is, okay, if recycling is not the solution to the root cause of waste, what is? And how do we get there? And I always think in any sort of big innovation, you can't just accept the problem for what it is. It's important to take a step back and understand how did the problem come to exist. And in writing a lot of books on waste, I can pinpoint that really the idea of garbage was invented only about 70 years ago, in the 1950s, when disposability came onto the scene. Disposability won in a massive way, not just in consumer goods, but clothing and furniture, I mean, almost everything, because it brought about unparalleled convenience and affordability. But then what was life like before? You know, 1930, 1920, 1940, and it looked like this. You know, this is the sort of iconic version, the milkman, if you will. But it wasn't just milk, it was motor oil, it was perfume, it was many, many things. You know, an interesting statistic from the clothing industry is that if you were alive in, say, middle-income woman in 1920 in Paris, you would buy 2 apparel items per year and use them for 20 years before disposal. Today, a middle-income Parisian lady in 2019 buys 65 apparel items and uses them on average 3 times before disposal, let alone a length of time like 20 years. Now, the interesting thing in the learning of models like these in the past was that products and the packages were many times the property of the maker. And they were financially motivated to make them long-lasting and durable. And then what happened in the 1950s, and by the way, this is an actual advertisement promoting disposability. This is someone paid to put this out. Now, it's funny, we laugh at it now, right? But it's sort of like those cigarette ads from the 50s where your doctor recommends, you know, a smoke of Camel cigarettes. 50s must have been a sort of interesting time. But let alone, you know, the strange thing happened is the packaging, you know, this brought about unparalleled convenience and affordability, but the packaging became our property as consumers. And I'd argue none of us want to own a package the moment it's empty, which is a very, very short period of time. And it also then became a cost of good to manufacturers. And this became the foundational problem because every manufacturer wants to lower costs. Pepsi, who's one of the founding partners of Loop, this is mapping out their packaging progression from when they began in refillable bottles to where they're trending today, as every CPG is, which is going to thinner and lighter and more complex packaging. Now, the benefit of lightweighting is phenomenal. It makes packaging significantly, not even a little, but significantly cheaper, and it's also way less material used to create it. So it is more sustainable in its creation, and not just a little, but a lot. But 2 unintended negatives happen. The first negative is articulated by the blue line, which is that's the actual rate of recycling for each of these pack forms in the US today. And recycling crashes down, not because one is technically recyclable and the other is not. In fact, all 5 of these waste streams are technically recyclable. It's because there's progressively less profit for garbage companies to go out and recover. And by the time you get to a multi-layered laminate, it is more cost for a garbage company to collect and recycle that than the results are worth, and that's the big white elephant in the room in recycling. Many people focus on, can you technically recycle something? And with respect, it's sort of bullshit. What really needs to be thought about is, can you practically recycle something? And the only thing that matters, thank you. The only thing that matters in practical recyclability is the money. Garbage companies are urban miners, you know? Simple way to think about it, right? If I left a pile of gold on stage and said I don't want it, some of you may come up and take it. Happily, if I left a pile of shit on stage, you would have to pay someone to get rid of it. And that's the difference between recycling and not recyclable. That's it, period, nothing more. The other negative that happens is consumer delight degrades. When consumers are asked to say, what is their most favorite package out of these, they usually project to the glass bottle, and what is the least favorite, they project to the pouch. So the thesis statement for Loop became this, before we had the answer, was how do we solve for the unintended consequences of disposability, which is lowering consumer delight and the waste crisis, while maintaining the virtues, which is affordability and convenience. And the big breakthrough came in one simple example, and by the way, the prices here are made up just to protect the actual prices, but it came in shifting ownership. Why do you want to own a deodorant stick the moment it's empty? No one does. And in today, a disposable package, whatever is the price of that package, has to be fully impregnated into the content. So you're buying that deodorant stick, the package, every time you buy deodorant. On the right-hand side, you see the new deodorant stick Unilever developed for Loop, which is beautiful, made of alloys. It's incredibly nicer, but it's also much more expensive to make that. But you don't own it as a consumer, you simply borrow it. And that means what's in the price of your deodorant is the depreciation of that package, the total cost over the number of uses, plus the cost of cleaning. And in some cases it's a little more, in some cases a little less, but it's always in the same ballpark as disposability. And that was the key breakthrough that enabled Loop. It was shifting from disposable design, not just to reusable, but durable design. Because durable design enables three key benefits. Yes, it becomes reusable, which is about 75% better from a carbon footprint point of view in most products, but it also elevates design and features to levels never attainable before. This becomes your new ice cream package, which is now shipping in 3 states in the US, doing incredibly well. We're adding 3 more states this week. Here, for example, is what your new fabric container looks like. The most dramatic cap ever coming off a bottle. So that's what, you know, that's it. And it's, you know, not only beautiful, durable, but counterworthy, and in the future even with new features and benefits. And this is what it looks like live now. Live now in someone's home. Even small companies, this is a startup, are able to get into durable design, except looking at more stock packages. And we talked about plastic earlier. You know, plastic isn't the problem. This is actually a high-strength industrial or engineered plastic like polycarbonate. It's this idea of using once. With all the retail partners, again, whether it's Unilever doing refillable Hellmann's or Clorox now doing refillable ranch dressing, these are just moving from a simple design into more of what it used to be like. A lot of retailers have also now started putting their private label products into Loop, and what we found with our retail partners is that there's a whole ecosystem in an average US retailer with 300 to 400 SKUs that are already reuse plug and play friendly. They just never had a reuse model on them before. So spices, you know, condiments and honey and olive oil and many other examples, all you have to do is shift the model. The package doesn't have to change whatsoever. It was always reuse friendly, it just never had the opportunity to be reused. But that's also interesting is when the large organizations get involved, this is what then olive oil looks like. So there's a different sort of role of the large organization that can really push design and something like private label where there may not be that opportunity. Many companies are echoing their past. This is Tropicana now creating something that looked like a refillable bottle, Quaker in a stainless steel container. Companies like Coca-Cola actually bringing back their original bottle design, and objectively, Coke tastes better in glass than aluminum, than PET, and that's just fact. Here, for example, is what motor oil looks like. You know, motor oil used to be reusable. This is with Shell. Now they're creating the stainless steel container. This will be shipping, I think, late this year. But again, you don't even have to care about sustainability. It's the most beautiful motor oil package, I think, in the market today. So This is one of the things we really noticed. You know, there is a role of plastic. This is Cascade using ABS, which is an engineered plastic. By the way, now people are looking at that product significantly more counterworthy than in a very loud, multi-layered sachet before. This is seventh generation. Again, really sort of playing into the counterworthiness idea with beautiful frosted glass bottles. Or here is Clorox wipes in a stainless steel and engineered plastic top. It could be, you know, using stock packaging, all the way to completely brand new design. And many of our partners have really pushed that design. This is Ren, which is luxury skincare with Unilever, in a refillable glass bottle, but they've already released what next year's design will look like, which is still just as reusable, but look at the huge elevation from an aesthetic and just function point of view. This is what deodorant looks like, shipping, I think, early next year with Unilever, looking at all the different sort of equities in a completely reusable deodorant container. One of the things, I put this up, this is not a loop example, but one of the sort of unintuitive things we've learned is this idea of how does packaging age? This is an example Puma did, nothing to do with us, where they put wax relief into the shoe and the logo only becomes apparent when you use it and get it dirty. Here's a coffee cup doing the same principle of only putting enamel on certain parts of the cup, and as it gets dirty, you see a pattern. Pantene did this beautifully, where, so the actual photo is what Pantene is shipping right now in loop. But that's a design for what next year's bottle may look like. And what they did there is put two layers of metal, so the outside layer attracts scratches as it goes from bathroom to bathroom to bathroom, while the inside layer does not. And so the logo becomes higher contrast as it's used, this idea of aging gracefully, like a bottle of red wine, if you will. The last example I want to show you is this really idea of how innovation plays and some of the rules we have to create. So this is Crest mouthwash in a reusable container. And one of the things I love seeing is how competitive organizations are looking at these designs and saying, how can we keep improving on each other and using the competitive landscape in a very positive way? So this is Colgate's reaction to the Crest mouthwash container. And this is mouthwash through Colgate in loop. And what I'm really sort of enjoying in this is it's a totally blue sky scenario where there's so many new innovations that can be done that were simply never possible before in disposable design, because disposable design has a very low budget context to play with. When Unilever had to look at, say, continuing the oral care category, something like toothpaste, you can't do today a tube in reusable packaging, maybe one day, but not today. So they went with a glass container. But it's hard to put paste into a glass container, so they also reformulated the toothpaste to be single-dose dehydrated tablets, which means no water, perfect dosage, and as a bonus, you can travel with it. And then became the question of, well, what do we do about content? Because packaging, yes, going to reusable packaging is intuitive, but what about the content? And we realized that there's three types of content. There is content you cannot recover, like toothpaste, so there'll be no point of view. But what about content you can recover? And within content you can recover, probably best articulated by this toothbrush by Oral-B, is there's certain parts that no matter how well we clean, you wouldn't be comfortable reusing, like the top of the brush. But there's parts you may be comfortable seeing reused, like the bottom. So when this brush comes back, the top is separated, goes to recycling, and the bottom you keep reusing. And here's what your new manual toothbrush looks like in loop.
Hey, no, I love it when it goes my way.
I think this is the bottom line future we have to think about in sustainability. We can't make it sacrifice-based. We need to think about what is the future of how we want to live. And within that future, of course, concepts like the idea of waste shouldn't exist. So loop is shipping. It's been shipping now for 4 weeks in France, 3 weeks in the US, doing well. These are some Instagram photos of people when they receive their shipment. And we're very proud that publicly we are as 5 retailers we've announced so far. There's another 5 around the world that will be announced over the next 6 months. But it's all about integrating and partnership. It's about partnering with consumer product companies to do what you saw there, and then partnering with retailers to embed the platform into their digital and physical stores. And so hopefully this gives you a little taste of how we try to think about the world of waste just a little differently. Thank you.